Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. I'm Dr. Shahid Maqbool, Virak, from Medical Unit 4. Today, I will have a discussion with you a very important topic for clinical examination and for theory examination of final year, that is tumors of lungs and respiratory tract. First of all, I will give you a little bit about the respiratory tract. Respiratory tract is broadly classified into two parts: upper respiratory tract, which starts from the nose, nasal cavity, paranasal sinuses and pharynx, and lower respiratory tract, which is comprised of trachea, bronchial tree, bronchopulmonary segments and alveoli. And what is tumor? Tumor is classified as an abnormal mass of tissue that results when cells divide more than they should or do not die when they should. Types of tumor. There are two types of tumors. One is benign and other one is malignant. What is benign? A growth that is not cancer and it does not invade nearby tissue or spread to other parts of the body. And the malignant, the term for disease in which abnormal cells divide without control and can invade nearby tissues, and it spreads through blood and lymphatic system. Bronchogenic carcinoma. Now we will start discussion of the bronchogenic carcinoma. A little bit introduction. Malignant proliferation of cells arising from the bronchial epithelium or mucous glands, and although it's largely preventable, carcinoma of the lung, and it is the most common cause of cancer death in men and the second most common cause in women after breast cancer. The most rapidly increasing cancer in developing countries like Pakistan. In etiology, cigarette smoking, both active and passive smoking, then the radiations and the radon gases and the asbestos. Asbestos has a synergistic effect with cigarette smoking in causing lung cancer, and also it causes mesothelioma, which is different from lung cancer. Other etiologies are air pollution, genetics and others, arsenic, inorganic arsenic compounds and different types of other chemicals. Classification. Bronchogenic carcinoma is classified as primary, which is very rare, like hematomas, squamous papillomatomas, pleomorphic adenoma, bronchial carcinoma, and very common, which one is the malignant, and metastatic is also very common. Classification based on the behavior and characteristics of the disease and its response to treatment. It is classified in small cell lung carcinomas and the non-small cell lung cancer or carcinoma. This slide will tell you about the classification, that most common cause of squamous cell carcinoma is which is of 35%, adenocarcinoma is 30%, and small cell carcinoma is 20%, and large cell carcinoma is 15%. Learn a little bit about the squamous cell carcinoma. It is the most commonest type, approximately 35 to 40% are the carcinomas. And this is the histopathology of the squamous cell carcinoma. This is adenocarcinoma. Adenocarcinoma, as far as the MCQs are concerned, you must know that the most common bronchial carcinoma associated with asbestos. And it is also most common in non-smokers, women, elderly and Far East. These points are very important for your MCQs. And the malignant, the term for disease in which abnormal cell carcinoma, this is showing the small cell carcinoma. Another name of small cell carcinoma is Oort cell carcinoma. Then the spread. One is the direct spread, and other one is the lymphatic spread, and third one is the heterogeneous spread. Spread means metastasis. Directly when a malignant tissue invades, first of all, the pleura, then the chest wall, then it might invade the intercostal nerves, then it might invade brachial plexus. Then the second type of spread is the metastatic lymph nodes spread. That is the mediastinal lymph nodes. When they enlarge, they cause compression of the pericardium, esophagus. They might cause spirit vena cava obstruction. They might cause tracheal obstruction, phrenic and left recurrent laryngeal nerve compression. And third type of spread is the heterogeneous. It can invade to the liver, the bones, and the brain, adrenals, and the skin. Now the clinical features. Keeping in view the previous slides which I have told you, now I will describe the clinical features. First of all, to understand the clinical features, there are these may be due to local tumor effects, metastatic tumor effects, and paraneoplastic manifestations. Many patients have no specific signs and only incidental finding on the X-ray or the CT scan. Local tumor effect. Persistent cough or change in usual cough. Patient may present with hemoptysis. Patient may present with chest pain, suggest chest wall or pleural environment, unresolving pneumonia or lobar collapse, unexplained dyspnea due to bronchial narrowing or obstruction, wheeze or stridor. Some of the patient might present with shoulder pain, some will present with pleural effusion, and some will present with hoarseness of voice. Hoarseness of voice arises when tumor invasion of the left recurrent laryngeal nerve and dysphagia and raised hemidiaphragm. Further local tumor effects, pleural vena cava obstruction syndrome. Patient might present with Horner syndrome. You must be familiar with Horner syndrome. This is one of the most common MCQs. And Horner syndrome comprises of meiosis, ptosis, enophthalmos, and hidrosis due to apical or pan-coast tumor damaging the sympathetic chain. Pan-coast tumor can also directly invade the ribs and the brachial plexus, causing C8T1 dermatome numbness, shoulder pain, and weakness of the small muscles of the hand. Metastatic tumor effects. Second type of clinical features which will arise that depends upon the metastasis. When they have different type of metastasis, first of all, cervical supraclavicular lymphadenopathy, common present in 30% and may be an easy site for diagnostic biopsy. Patient might present with palpable liver edge. Patient might present with bone pains, pathological fractures due to the bone, metastasis. Furthermore, metastatic tumor effects, patient may present with hypercalcemic effects due to bony metastasis or direct tumor production of parathyroid hormone related peptide. Or patient may present with dysphagia, compression from large mediastinal nodes. Paraneoplastic syndrome. Patient might present with endocrine syndromes are due to the ectopic production of hormones or hormonally active peptides. Neurological syndromes are due to antibody-mediated CNS damage. Paraneoplastic syndromes. Patient might present with cachexia and wasting. Patient may present with clubbing. Up to 29% of the patient, any cell type can present. But the most commonest, it is present in squamous and adenocell carcinoma. You might have these type of MCQs in your theory examination. Patient may present with hypertrophic pulmonary osteoarthropathy. Patient may present with gynecomastia. Further paraneoplastic syndrome, you must be familiar that ectopic ACTH production. This is called Cushing syndrome. Then the cerebellar syndrome. Then the limbic encephalitis. And then the dermatomyositis, polymyositis, and even some of the patient can present with glomerulonephritis. In etiology, cigarette smoking, both active and passive smoking. After all the clinical features, now we will jump to the investigations. First of all, the blood investigations. After the different type of cumulative blood count, random blood sugar, urea and creatinine, some of the most important that including serum electrolytes, that is sodium, then the calcium, and the liver function test. check the clotting if biopsy is planned. That means if you are planning some of the diagnostic biopsy incision, or especially the excision biopsy, if you are planning, then you have to look for the clotting profile, that is the bleeding time, the clotting time, the prothrombin time, and activated partial thromboplastin time, that is APTT. Then sputum complete examination, and then the sputum cytology. Then the chest X-ray examination, which is also one of the most important. This will help for diagnosing the location of the lesion and planning further investigations, pleural involvement, pleural effusion, and rib destruction and intrathoracic metastasis. Chest X-ray can be normal. Excision biopsy as well. Then the CT scan. CT scan of the different parts of the body to stage, that is the neck, chest, liver, adrenals, to assess tumor site and size. Then the ultrasonography of the neck or liver may provide information about enlarged lymph nodes or metastasis suitable for biopsy. Then the MRI. Then investigation is the bone scan, indicated if any suggestion of metastatic disease such as bony pains, pathological fractures, hypercalcemia, raised alkaline ALP levels, highly suggestive of bony metastasis, and we have to go on for the bone scan. Then the CT head, indicated if any neurological deficit or any central some of the clinical features like persistent headache, vomiting. Then investigation is the positron emission tomography, PET scanning. This will show some of the common radiological presentations of the bronchial carcinoma. You can understand from here. This is the large cavitated bronchial carcinoma in the left lung. You might have these X-rays in your clinical examination of the final year exams. Excision biopsy as well. Then the CT scan. CT scan of the different parts of the body to stage, that is the neck, chest, liver. Then this is the pulmonary metastasis, bilateral cannonball shadows, the bilateral paratracheal lymphadenopathy there. Then this is a CT scan, this is the PET scan, and this is the multiple areas of increased uptake. This type of scan is called bone scan. Then the TNM classification, this slide will help you to understand the TNM classification. This is the TNM classification. Now we will move to the management. First of all, the management comprises of five different types of management plans. First is the general management. Second one is the radiotherapy. Third one is the chemotherapy. Then one of the latest technique is the laser therapy. And fifth one, the surgical resection in patients suitable for TNM classification for surgery. General management. Patient might have some pains, so we have to relieve the pain. We have to suggest for a good diet and specific therapy to treat anxiety and depression, treat hypercalcemia, and manage malignant pleural effusions. Then the radiotherapy. There are many indications of radiotherapy, but some of them I have written here, that's period, venous cable syndrome, recurrent hemoptysis, pain caused by the chest wall invasion or skeletal metastasis, to relieve obstruction of trachea and main bronchi with chemotherapy. It can prevent brain metastasis in small cell carcinoma. Then investigation is the bone scan, indicated if any suggestion of metastatic disease such as bony pains, pathological fractures, hypercalcemia, raised alkaline. Then the laser therapy via fiber optic bronchoscopy. This is the latest technique, palliative treatment, and we can even destroy the tumor tissue, including major airways, to allow re-aeration of the collapsed lung to relieve the symptoms. And the final management is the surgery. And so we have to make a TNM classification and plan surgery. Surgery is performed in early stage non-small cell cancer, stage 1, stage 2, and selected patient of the stage 3 with curative intent. Many patients with stage 3 disease are treated with chemo radiation with a view to downstaging disease and render it amenable to surgical resection. I have some of the multiple choice questions. You can study from here. there are different types of questions you can and